Dear students, today we will discuss underground cables. According to the type of construction, the supply system, either distribution or transmission, can be divided into two types. First is overhead system and the second is underground system. Overhead system is 5 to 10 times cheaper than underground system for the same parameters, which means that for a same voltage and current rating, the overhead system will be 5 to 10 times cheaper than underground system. Underground system is used and preferred where the overhead system is impractical or prohibited, and mostly it occurs in the densely populated area. So overhead system is not preferred in the densely populated area, so we use underground system. In the underground system, the electrical energy is transmitted through the underground cables. And in our today's lecture, we will discuss the power cables which are used in the power system. And the contents of the today's lecture will be introduction to the underground cables, construction of the underground cables, properties of the insulation material used for the power cables, and types and construction and types and properties of some common insulation materials, length of underground cables, dielectric stress in the power cables, economical conductor size in the cable, and grading of the cables. Now, what is underground cables? It is basically one or more conductors which are covered with suitable insulation and protecting cover. The cable selection is based upon the worth-in voltage and service requirement. Means one should select the cable according to the voltage requirement, which means if he is using higher voltage, then the size of the cable or the gauge of the cable will be according to that. For low voltages, low size or low grade cable is used, and for higher voltage, high gauge cable is used. And the conductor which is used in the cables is actually tinned stranded copper or aluminium of higher conductivity, and the stranding is done in the conductors to make the conductor more flexible and to carry more current. The conductor size should be such that the cable carries the desired load current without overheating and causing the voltage drop within the permissible limit. It means that you should select the conductor size according to your power rating or current rating. If the conductor size is not according to the current rating, then due to resistance, the conductor will overheat, which will damage the insulation and will produce short circuiting. The cable must be proper thickness of insulation in order to give high degree of safety and reliability at voltage for which it is designed. means around the conductors we use proper thickness of insulation which gives safety and reliability to the system. Next, the cable must be provided with suitable mechanical protection so that it can withstand any rough use during laying of the conductor. The material used in manufacturing of cable should be such that there is complete chemical and physical stability throughout the conductor. Now, the next thing is construction of cable. Students, in front of you is a diagram of three conductor cable. Here, these three are the conductors, and above that we have a paper insulation, and above the paper insulation we have a lead sheet, and above the lead sheet we have a bedding. Around the bedding we use armoring, and above all of them there is a layer of surveying. We will discuss all of these in detail. And the same thing in the front view is shown here. Now, what is core or conductors? A cable may have one or more core or conductors depending upon the type of service. For example, a three conductor cable is used for a three phase service or three phase system. Insulation: the core or conductor is provided with a suitable thickness of insulation, and the common insulations are impregnated paper, varnished tempered or rubbed mineral compound. The thickness of layers depend upon voltage to be withstood by the cable. If the higher voltage is, the thickness of insulation will be high, and for lower voltage you then use less amount of insulation. Metallic sheath: it protects the cable from moisture, gases or other damaging liquids such as acids and alkalis which are present in the soil and atmosphere. Bedding: bedding is over the metallic sheath, there is a layer of bedding which consists of a fibrous material like jute or a hessian tape. Students, the jute is actually a woven material, and hessian tape is also a woven material. Both are almost same, but the difference is in the quality. Hessian is being made of finer grade than jute. And in front of you here is the diagram of jute fibers or jute cables. These are basically thread-like structures which are oftenly used to absorb humidity or moisture. Now, the bedding protects the metallic sheath against corrosion and from mechanical injury due to armoring. Over the bedding is a layer of armoring. It consists of one or two layers of galvanized steel wire or steel tape. Galvanizing involves coating of a stainless steel wire, and this coating protects the table from mechanical injury while laying and handling the table. And above all of them is a layer of servin. The layer of servin means it is a fibrous material like jute and is provided over the armoring to protect armoring from atmospheric conditions. Now, what are the properties of insulation material used in power tables, or what are the properties of material which must have in power tables? First of all, the insulation material which is used in power tables must have high insulation resistance to avoid any leakage current. Second thing is, the material must have high dielectric strength to avoid electrical breakdown of the cable. The material must have high mechanical strength to withstand the mechanical handling of the cable. The material must be non-hydroscopic, so it should not absorb moisture from the air or soil. And if the material is hydroscopic, then it must be enclosed in a waterproof covering like lead sheet. And the material of cable must be non-inflammable. And the material which is used in power cables as insulation must be of low cost. And the material should be unaffected by acids, so that there must not be any chemical reaction. And these are the few types of insulation which are used in the cables. First of all, we will study rubber. The rubber is obtained from milky sap of tropical trees, or it can be produced from oil products. The rubber have relative permittivity which varies between 2 and 3. The dielectric strength of rubber is about 30 kV per millimeter, and the resistivity of insulation is 10 raised to power 17 ohm centimeter. The pure rubber has high insulation properties, but it absorbs moisture and maximum safe temperature is low, which is around 38 degrees centigrade. It is soft and liable to damage due to rough handling and ages when exposed to light. So the pure rubber is not used in insulation material. The next thing is vulcanized Indian rubber, or VIR. The VIR is prepared by mixing the pure rubber with zinc oxide, lead, and 3 to 5% of the sulfur, and the compound is then applied to conductor and is heated to a temperature of 150 degrees centigrade. the VIR has greater mechanical strength, durability and wear resistant property than pure rubber, but it also has a drawback, which is the sulfur in the VIR reacts very quickly with the copper, so the cable used in VIR have tin copper conductor. VIR are used in low and moderate voltage levels. Next is impregnated paper. It consists of a chemically pulped paper and impregnated with some compounds such as paraffinic or naphthenic materials. Impregnated paper is better than rubber insulation because it has low cost, low capacitance, high dielectric strength and high insulation resistance. The only disadvantage of using impregnated paper as insulation is the paper is hygroscopic, which means that it absorbs moisture and reduces the insulation resistance of cable. So the paper insulation are always provided with some protective covering. And the last one is polyvinyl chloride, or simply PVC. It is the most commonly used insulation material. It is actually a synthetic compound which is obtained from the polymerization of acetylene, and it is in the form of white powder. The PVC insulation is made by mixing the PVC with plasticizers. Plasticizers are liquids with high boiling points. The PVC has high insulation resistance, good dielectric strength and high mechanical strength over a wide range of temperatures. The PVC is preferred over VIR when the conditions are extreme. Now, the classifications of cable are of two categories, means we classify cables on the basis of these two points, which is the type of insulation material used in their manufacturer, or the cable can be classified on the basis of voltage level for which they are manufactured. And above and among these two classifications, the voltage level is mostly preferred. Now, according to the voltage level, the cable is classified in the following types. The first one is low tension LT cables, and these are used up to voltage of 1000 volt or 1 kV. Next is high tension HT cables, and they are used up to voltage of 11,000 volt or 11 kV. Next is super tension cable or ST cables, and they are used from 22 kV to 33 kV. नेक्स्ट इज एक्स्ट्रा हाई टेंशन और EHT केबल एंड दे आर यूज फ्रॉम 33 kV टू 66 kV. नेक्स्ट इज एक्स्ट्रा सुपर वोल्टेज ESV केबल और दे आर यूज फॉर द वोल्टेज विच आर ग्रेटर देन 132 kV. एंड डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द सर्विस आइदर वोल्टेज और करंट रेटिंग द केबल मे बी क्लासिफाइड एज सिंगल कोर, टू कोर, थ्री कोर एंड फोर कोर. Now the cables for the three-phase system to deliver a three-phase power we have two options. Either we use three-core cable, means a cable which is having three core or three conductors, or we can use three single core cables. For the voltage up to 66 kV, 3-core cable is preferred due to economic reasons. And for the voltage beyond 66 kV, the 3-core cable becomes too large, so we use single core cable. And the following types of cable are generally used in three-phase system. First one is belted type. These cables are used up to voltage of 11 kV. Next is screened cable. They are used from voltage of 22 kV to 66 kV. And last one is pressure cable, which is used for voltage above 66 kV. In these two figures, we have a single core low tension cable. Here you can see there is the blue dots. The blue shaded area is a copper conductor, a standard copper conductor, and it shows that it is a single core, while in this figure the black region is indicating the three core or three conductor which are covered with insulation, and all the three cores are further covered with this insulation, and above all we have lead sheath. Now, what are belted cables? The belted cables are used for voltage up to 11 kV, or in some cases they can be used in 22 kV system. The core layers are insulated by impregnated paper, and another layer of impregnated paper tape called the paper tape is wound around the group of insulated cores. The gap between insulated core is filled with fibrous insulating material jute to give circular cross section to the cable. The belt is covered with lead sheath, which protects the cable against moisture and mechanical strength. The lead sheath is covered with multi-layer of armoring with an outer serving belted type construction is suitable for low and medium voltages, as the electrostatic stress developed is radial. विच मीन्स द इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक स्ट्रेस इज अक्रॉस द इंसुलेशन एंड फॉर वोल्टेज इज द ग्रेटर देन 22 kV द टेंजेंशियल स्ट्रेसेज आर ऑल्सो कंसिडर्ड विच आर एक्टिंग अलोंग द लेयर्स ऑफ पेपर इंसुलेशन एंड ड्यू टू लेस इंसुलेशन रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ पेपर द स्ट्रेसेज सेट अप अ लीकेज करंट अलोंग द पेपर इंसुलेशन विच रिजल्ट्स इन हीट प्रोडक्शन एंड ड्यू टू हीट इट कैन कॉज ब्रेक डाउन इन द केबल एंड टू प्रिवेंट दिस लीकेज स्क्रीनड केबल्स आर यूज्ड वेयर द लीकेज करंट आर कंडक्टेड टू अर्थ थ्रू मेटेलिक स्क्रीन्स. नेक्स्ट वी हैव स्क्रीनड केबल्स एंड द स्क्रीनड केबल्स आर फर्दर क्लासिफाइड इन टू एच टाइप केबल्स एंड एस एल टाइप केबल्स. अदर कैटेगरी ऑफ द केबल्स इज प्रेशर केबल. द प्रेशर केबल इज क्लासिफाइड इन टू टू टाइप्स. फर्स्ट इज ऑयल फील्ड केबल एंड नेक्स्ट इज गैस प्रेशर केबल. The next topic we will be discussing is the laying of underground cables, which means how underground cables are laid. The reliability of underground cables depend upon the proper laying and attachment of fittings, which can be cables and boxes, joints, branch connectors. The cable can be laid underground by different mechanisms. The first one is direct laying. In the figure you can see the blue circle is showing the cable which is enclosed in a trench. This method is simple, cheaper, and much favored in the modern practice. A trench which is about 1.5 meters deep and 45 centimeters wide is dug in the ground. This trench is covered with a layer of fine sand which is about 10 centimeters thick. And the cable is laid over the sand bed. The sand prevents the entry of moisture and protects the cable from the decay. After the cable has been laid into the trench, it is covered with another layer of sand which thickness is around 10 cm. The trench is then covered with bricks to protect the cable from mechanical injuries. And if we have more than one cable in a same trench, then a horizontal and vertical spacing of at least 30 cm must be provided to reduce the effect of mutual heating and to ensure that the fault on one table does not affect or damage the adjacent table. The Hessian tapes are also used for protection against corrosion and electrolysis. This method have some advantages and disadvantages. The advantage of direct line is it is simple and less costly. It gives the best condition for dissipating the heat. It is clean and safe method as the cable is invisible and free from external disturbance. The disadvantages of this method are, if we want to extend the load then we need to completely excavate, which is very cost effective. Means in the old trenches we cannot lay the new cables, we have to make new excavation. And if the alteration in cable network is required, it is very difficult. The maintenance cost of this method is very high. The localization of fault is very difficult, and it cannot be used in the congested area where the excavation is expensive. Next method is draw in system. Ducts of the glazed stone or cast iron or concrete are laid in ground with manholes at suitable position along the cable route. In the figure you can see these blue circles are ducts which are enclosed in concrete covering, and in the ducts we laid the power cables. The cables are then pulled into position from the main holes. Three of the ducts carry transmission cables, while the fourth duct carries relay protection connections and pilot wires. And where the duct line changes direction, the depth, dip and offset be made with larger radius. Otherwise, it will be difficult to pull a large cable between the manholes. The distance between manholes should be near for easy pulling in the cable. And this method does not require armoring. This method have some advantages and disadvantages. The advantages of this method is the repair and alteration or addition to the cable network can be made without opening the ground, as manholes serve the purpose. Joints become simpler and maintenance cost is less because the cables are not armored, and there are less chances of fault occurrence because of strong mechanical protection. And the disadvantages are the initial cost of this system is high because of manholes and concrete laying. The current carrying capacity of cables is less due to close grouping of cables, and the condition becomes unfavorable for the dissipation of heat. This method of cable laying is suitable for congested area where excavation is expensive and inconvenient. Next is solid system. The cable is laid in open pipes or troughs, and the troughs can be made of cast iron, stoneware, assaults or treated wood, which are dug out in earth along the cable route. After the cable is laid in the position, the troughing is filled with a bituminous or assaulted compound and covered over. The cables laid in this manner are usually plain lead covered because the troughing afford good mechanical protection. This method also have some disadvantages, which are it is expensive method than direct laid system. It required skilled labor and favorable weather conditions. and due to poor heat dissipation, the current carrying capacity of table is reduced. In view of all these disadvantages, this method of laying underground tables is rarely used nowadays. It means the solid system is not preferred nowadays due to these disadvantages. Next, we have dielectric strength in a single core table. In the figure, you can see this innermost blue circle is showing a single core or single conductor, and around this we have insulation. At the core, this Gmax is showing that gradient of voltage is maximum, and on the surface of insulation the gradient is minimum. The gradient decreases as we move away from the conductor. Here the small d is representing the diameter of conductor, and capital D is showing the diameter of cable. And for normal operating conditions, the insulation of cable is subjected to electrostatic forces, which are called dielectric stress. This dielectric stress at any point of the cable is, in fact, the potential gradient electric intensity at that point. And the electric intensity at a point which is x meters from the center of cable is given by this equation, where the Q is charge in dielectric, or the charge due to dielectric effect. Epsilon naught is permittivity of free space. ER is relative permittivity of the material, and h is a distance which is taken from the center of cable. And the potential gradient G, which is same as electrical intensity E at a point h meter from the center of cable, can be given as G is equal to EH. So this equation EH will be replaced by G. Now G is equal to Q over 2 pi epsilon naught ER into H, volts per meter. And the potential difference V between conductors and the sheath is this equation. This equation is given in the capacitance of cable. And from this, if we arrange V that Q is equal to 2 pi epsilon naught ER V divided by log D over D. Here I want to tell you what is sheath. Sheath is a protective covering around electric cable. Now if we substitute the value of this Q in equation number 1, we get G is equal to V over X into log D over small d volts per meter. And from this equation, we see that the potential gradient G is inversely proportional to the distance h, which means that as the distance h increases, potential G decreases, the potential gradient will be maximum when the value of X is minimum, which means when X is equal to D over 2 or at the surface of conductor where D over 2 is radius and X is equal to radius means that the point is on the surface of conductor and the potential gradient will be minimum at X is equal to capital D over 2 or at the sheath of surface. So putting these values in equation number 3, we that the maximum potential gradient is G max is equal to 2V divided by D log of D over small d, and it is obtained by putting X is equal to D over 2 in expression 3. And for minimum potential gradient, we put X is equal to capital D over 2 in expression number 3. And with that, this equation where G minimum is equal to 2V divided by D, where D is the diameter of cable, log of D over D. And if we want to know the most economical size conductor in a cable, we want to know the most economical conductor size in a cable. As we know, the mechanical stress in a cable occurs at the surface of conductor, and the maximum value of stress is given as this equation. From this equation, we see that the working voltage V and internal sheath diameter capital D are fixed value for a certain design, which means that in equation 1 only conductor diameter small d is the variable, and for a given V and D, the most economical conductor diameter will be one for which G max has a minimum value. Means equation 1 will be having a minimum value, then G max will be maximum. So the value of G max will be minimum when the denominator is maximum, and the maximum value of denominator is obtained by taking the derivative and setting it to 0. As you can see here, we took the derivative of denominator and set it to 0. Here this small d and this small d both are variables. So by the properties of derivative, we that this equation, and after solving the equation, we have the net result is D over D, where capital D is diameter of sheath from the center and small d is diameter of the conductor. Well, D over D is equal to E, which is equal to 2.718. So the most economical conductor diameter will be D is equal to diameter of cable divided by 2.718. And if we put this value, we get the value of G max in this condition will be G max is equal to 2V over D. Now we will study the gradient of tables. Gradient is actually the achievement of uniform electrostatic stress in the dielectric region of table. As we have discussed earlier that in the tables there is a dielectric stress or electrostatic stress, and the gradient is to make the dielectric stress or electrostatic stress uniform. And gradient is done by two methods. The first one is capacitance gradient. In the figure, the innermost shaded region is showing the conductor, and we have taken three different layers in a spherical shape with innermost having diameter of d1, then d2, and the outermost is having the diameter of d. The diameter of the conductor is d. Then the capacitance gradient means the process of achieving uniformity in the dielectric stress by using layers of different dielectrics. In these layers, the epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3, these three are different relative permittivity of, and here epsilon 1 will be greater than epsilon 2 and epsilon 2 will be greater than epsilon 3, and all of them are operating at same stress. And from the figure we have 1 over epsilon 1 into d, 1 over epsilon 2 into d1, and 1 over epsilon 3 into d2. And from this equation we have epsilon 1 into d is equal to epsilon 2 into d1 and is equal to epsilon 3 into d2. And if we want to know the voltage at point 1, we just have to integrate the gradient from the radius of conductor to the first layer around the conductor, which have diameter of d1. So as we integrate, we get this equation. The resultant equation is this, where V1, the voltage at point 1 or the voltage at layer 1, is equal to G max over 2 into D. Into log of E d1 over d. In the same way, the potential at layer 2 and layer 3 can be obtained by this method, where V2 will be equal to G max over 2 into d1 log of d2 over d1, where d2 is diameter of the second layer and d1 is the diameter of first layer around the conductor. In the same way, we think that V3, the total potential difference between the core and sheath, will be the sum of all the three voltages, which is V is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3. And if we put the values of V1, V2 and V3 and add them, we get this equation. And for homogeneous dielectrics and for the same value of D, diameter of conductor, and D, diameter of sheath, and G max, the permissible potential difference between core and sheath would have been this equation. Here we can see the voltage is directly proportional to the gradient and diameter of the conductor. The next method of grading is intersheath grading. In the figure, you can see that the black shaded part is showing the conductor, and above this conductor we have these blue layers, and the diameter of these layers is D1, D2 and capital D, where capital D is diameter of the cable or diameter of sheath from the center of conductor. So a homogeneous dielectric with multiple layers is used by placing a metallic intersheath between core and lead sheath. The intersheath are held at suitable potential, which are in between the core potential and the earth potential. This improves the voltage distribution in the dielectric of cable, and consequently more uniform potential gradient is obtained. We know the equation used for G max, and we apply it on this figure, so we get the G1 max is equal to V1 over D over 2 log of D1 over D. In the same way, we get G2 max and G3 max. As the dielectric is homogeneous, so all the gradients will be equal, which means that V1 over D over 2 log of E D1 over D will be equal to G2 max and G3 max. So we set all these G1 max, G2 max and G3 max equals to G max. And if we want to know the voltage between conductor and earthen lead or sheath, we simply add the voltages at all the three layers, which are V1, V2 and V3. So dear students, it was all from the power cables or underground cables. Hope you have understood the topic. Still, if you have any questions, you can ask me in the comments.